Hello, I'm Shelley Broderick, Dean of the UDC David A. Clarke School of Law and your host for Sound Advice. Many of us know about the work of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law in working with the private bar to litigate high-profile racial discrimination cases. Litigation continues to be an important strategy in the fight for equal justice, but the Community Development Project, or CDP, of the Lawyers Committee expands the quest for equality to the transactional realm. The CDP provides free legal services to nonprofit and community-based organizations to promote housing and economic opportunities and environmental justice in low-income and minority communities. CDP attorneys partner with attorneys from law firms specializing in real estate, land use, environmental contracts, corporate, and tax law to provide free, high-quality community organizing and advocacy campaign legal support and transactional legal assistance. The CDP's latest partnership is with the Community Development Law Clinic here at UDC, David A. Clarke School of Law. With me today to discuss the work of the CDP are Associate Counsel David Zisser and 2L Clinic students Eva Seidelman and Emily Satowski. Hello, welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for inviting us.
I am delighted to have you all, and I'm dying to hear about the project. But first, Eva, tell me a little bit about what brought you to UDC.
Well, I actually worked as a union organizer for a few years, and then I worked as an advocate here in D.C. For international labor rights. And I was inspired by the lawyer at the organization I worked at. I wanted to learn how to articulate myself and use the law to advocate for low-income and working-class people. So I found out about UDC David A. Clarke School of Law, and it seemed absolutely perfect. Public interest, law school, advocating for the community here in D.C., and got a great scholarship, and I'm really enjoying it now.
Music to my ears. You couldn't have given a better answer if I'd written it myself. I'm delighted to hear that. And you went to Oberlin undergrad.
I did go to Oberlin.
And I know that our former dean, Bill Robinson, told me he met you and encouraged you to come to UDC. So you never had a chance. There was no option for you, Eva.
Yeah.
Emily, how about you?
Dean Broderick, actually, it's a very similar, Eva and I have a similar background. I was also an organizer. I have a labor organizing background. I cut my teeth as a labor organizer in college, and then also moved on to some international solidarity work, back to labor organizing, and then I was the operations director for the Green Party of the United States, and I really wanted to go to law school and sort of take my commitment to social justice, to environmental justice, to another level, and UDC was the place to go.
Well, I can end now. I don't really have to go. No, I love it, and I love that you're Green Party. I'm actually a card-carrying statehood Green Party member in D.C. Okay. Myself. Doesn't get better. So, David, how about you?
Did all my schooling in California. I went to UCLA, and while there, as a senior, I had the opportunity to take some really fantastic classes with professors that I think I'll probably remember forever. And they ended up being mostly urban planning classes, and I came to really find a passion in community development and community-based work. I ended up doing some community organizing, not labor organizing, later in my career. But I decided I wanted to pursue community development in grad school, and then also realized as I was getting involved in that process of applying that I really wanted to make a living out of being an advocate for poor people. And I knew that having a law degree would help me be more effective at that, and ended up applying to dual degree programs, which I encourage people to do, in both urban planning and law, and ended up attending UC Hastings for law school and UC Berkeley for planning school.
And you interned at the Lawyers Committee at some point, right, as I recall, right?
Yeah, I want to say it was 2005. During law school, I did spend one summer in the same project that I'm now an attorney in, which is really wonderful, so that when the job did become available, I was fortunate to know some of the same people that I interned under. So,
and they said, wow, we can get him back. It's a deal.
I'd like to think that that's what they said.
I'm pretty sure that's what happened. So, David, tell us a little bit about the project work that the Lawyers Committee Project on Community Development.
Sure.
Tell me about what exactly kinds of things you do.
Sure. I generally sort of boil it down to three areas.
Okay.
The first is transactional work.
What is that?
Sure.
I know because faculty members have educated me, but I didn't used to know that. What is that?
Yeah, and I think a lot of people when they go to law school and even when they see it on TV, they think of being in the courtroom litigating. We don't do that in the community development project, although we work closely with litigators in some cases. But transactional law involves contracts. It literally deals with transactions between two or more parties. So we're drafting agreements and contracts that have to do with purchasing land or developing affordable housing or doing commercial redevelopment. To address things like blight and gentrification and displacement of low-income people. That's generally what happens in the transactional realm. The second one is sort of related. It has to do with incorporation of nonprofit organizations that do this type of work. Generally, community development corporations or CDCs are some of the clients that we have. And sometimes they need to start a new organization. And we help with getting them 501c3 tax exempt status from the IRS and drafting their articles of incorporation, which are basically an organization's constitution and their bylaws, those two things together. And also helping board members understand their responsibilities and structuring the board in a way that makes sense for that organization and their goals. So that's sort of the second area. The third area is the one I actually care about the most and I think is the most fun. It's supporting community organizing and advocacy campaigns. Groups that want to organize around, for instance, a port expansion in Gulfport that they're worried will have health and environmental impacts on the African American community and want to make sure that jobs that the port creates go to low and moderate income people. Well, we're helping them with legal research and strategy development to make sure that that campaign is effective. And we're doing it in a way that is not litigation right now. We don't know what the future holds, but we're trying to get that group to do a community benefits agreement, which I can explain later if you'd like. But that's part of their campaign. So really supporting these grassroots campaigns with legal capacity that they otherwise wouldn't be able to afford.
So let me break this down a little bit in my own head.
Sure.
So Gulfport needs to enlarge the port. It's a city in Louisiana.
Mm-hmm. Mississippi.
Hate to say it, being an East Coaster, but yeah, same thing. No, my mother's from Louisiana,
that's
and
right.
I would be killed if I really thought that. Mm-hmm. So, so Gulfport, Mississippi needs to build a bigger port because that's how they make their money, and that's where most of their residents are employed, or it's a major economic engine, and so they've got to spend some money to make that happen. And folks in the community say, hey, wait a second. You're going to do this work, but it could have a negative impact on our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. It could take away housing because you're expanding into where there are areas where there are housing. It could actually, if done right, help us mm-hmm. because we could get jobs where we don't have jobs. Is that the kind of thing we're talking about? And so folks in the community pick up the phone and they call David Zisser at the Lawyers Committee and they say, David, help us.
Not exactly.
Okay, how
does this? And that is the gist, by the way. And the state of Louisiana under Governor Barber did decide to expand the port. And it's important to note, and I know this is just a side note, but they're using federal funds that were supposed to go for housing recovery and diverted it to the port expansion. So those are called community development block grant funds, and those are supposed to be used to primarily benefit low and moderate income communities. So we are helping this organization called the STEPS Coalition and their partners ensure that those funds are being spent in a way that actually does benefit those communities and doesn't have, or at least mitigates, the negative impacts of increased traffic that will result from a bigger port, that sort of thing. But to your question, they didn't pick up the phone. Well, about 2 years ago when I came to the Lawyers Committee, I was charged with expanding our work in the Gulf Coast. The Community Development Project has a really great history of working the coast. Even though it was started right before Katrina, with Katrina, the work's become much more important and relevant. And there's not this type of legal assistance in New Orleans, where most of our work is, or in Mississippi. So I went down there, made a lot of phone calls, had people put me in touch with community-based groups, and sat down around tables and said, here's what we do. What kind of work are you guys doing that you think lawyers would be useful on? And sometimes they didn't know how a lawyer would be useful, but that's my job, is to help them figure out where the legal issues are and how we can be helpful. And now we've got about 12 client organizations in New Orleans and three organizations in Mississippi that we're working with. And they're all doing amazing work, and we get to be a part of it in a small way. So
I just love it. You know, I went to law school. All I ever wanted to be was a criminal defense lawyer. I don't know. I blinked, and the next thing I knew, I was an administrator somehow. I still can't figure out how that happened. And I never for a minute thought about this kind of work. But what I like about it is really what you do is make deals that help whole communities.
It's true.
I mean, really what you do is try to carve out things that will benefit. You know, okay, you're gonna enlarge your port, what do we get? Mm-hmm. And you work with the community so that it's not what you think they should get, mm-hmm. it's what they think they should get, and maybe you help refine that thinking.
Sure.
But it really is a collaborative working together to build a community, and it's not just rich people or the government taking over.
That's right.
I love this. I might have to go back to law school. Well, I could just take the clinic.
Yeah. Or you could come volunteer with the Lawyers Committee.
In my copious free time, I'll be right over.
Okay.
Barbara Arnwine, your boss, spoke at the law school a few years ago, and I swear it made me want to quit my job and just go back to work as a lawyer.
She is very motivational.
She's fabulous.
Yeah. We all agree on that.
We love her to death. Oh my God, love her. So you guys came to UDC and you took the Community Development Law Clinic. And the next thing you know, you meet David. How did this all happen? What kind of work are you doing with the Lawyers Committee and David Zisser?
Let me set that up a little bit.
Okay.
Because some of it happened before them. And they're actually in the clinic right now and they're doing fantastic work working with four of our client organizations in New Orleans and Mississippi. And they'll talk more about those clients, I hope, and a recent trip they made to the area. But I thought it would be fun and helpful for us to work with a community development clinic. I had a great experience in mine at Hastings under a professor that I'll always adore named Mark Aronson.
I adore Mark Aronson.
Great.
Oh, my God. We can have the Mark Aronson fan club right here.
Oh, yeah. It's probably very big. I talked to him about a potential collaboration with a clinic locally. I wanted to work with groups so that students could come to my office and we could sit down and work together, and I could come to UDC or American or whatever. And turns out, you know, you all have two wonderful, I think it's more than that, but the two professors we're working with are Lori Moran and Louise Howells, and they've both been amazing. They're both actively involved in supervising the work with me of the students. And we started this collaboration before the beginning of this semester, and we agreed on four students that we would be able to host, and they come in once a week. And we have a lot of check-ins with the professors and with the students, and that's all I need to say. They can explain more.
How did you two get so lucky?
I don't know, but it's been great. I mean, it's just the Lawyers Committee has been, it's just been such a privilege to work with the Lawyers Committee, and the UDC clinic program is really why I chose UDC. So this is really been a great experience.
There's a magic to it. So talk about what project you're working on now.
So I'm working with the North Gulfport Community Land Trust and also with the Broadmoor Community Development Corporation, which is in New Orleans. The North Gulfport Land Trust is in Mississippi.
And they're right next to each other.
They're
about an hour away.
And what are you doing? What are the goals?
Sure. So the land trust is actually first of all, I want to talk a little bit about the North Gulfport Land Trust and specifically Rose Johnson, who is their executive director and very much the founder and very much the visionary behind the project. I mean, she's amazing. She has a she's from North Gulfport and also has a long history of environmental justice work, as well as
that means community. She has a lot of experience with environmental injustice.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
So what does it look like? What are the issues there?
So, the Land Trust was formed in 2004, and they formed in order to ensure that the community would remain together, consolidated. It's a North Gulfport and Turkey Creek, which is the neighboring area, are very important to Gulfport's African American community. The area was founded by freed men and women right after the Civil War, and it has been an important cultural center since then. Around 2004, the community realized that they faced that there was a lot of land speculation going on, where land would be bought and then resold to members of the community, or people were no longer able to afford to stay there. So this was
it.
A way. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's better.
That is the technical term.
Yeah.
That was something that those of us who aren't in the biz understand.
Right.
They bought it, they fixed it up, and they sold it for way more money, and all of a sudden, it's gentrification. The folks in the community can no longer afford their community.
Which is, which I think a lot of us are familiar with here in D.C.
Yes, indeed. So this will be translatable experience for when you...
But the land trust, like a lot of community land trusts, and it is a sort of a movement that's been going on for a few decades now, its goal really is to preserve land and keep it within community control. Mm-hmm. And in this case, they want to utilize a lot of the land, not all of it, and they have acquired a lot of properties, the land trust, and use it for low-income and moderate-income housing.
So one of the things that happens is wealthy people agree to come in and purchase some of the land and give it to the trust for this purpose, or people decide to leave in their estate this land to the trust. Over time, you begin to amass property?
I think mostly what's happened, and Rose Johnson could answer this better, but is the land trust was able to find relatively inexpensive land. There may have been some deeding of land from others, but they've slowly acquired different properties and really want to protect it from, as Emily said, from speculation, from commercial development, that sort of thing. And there's some of that going on. And really to use it as an opportunity for low-income homeownership, which is not always, available. And maybe you can talk a little bit about, with this goal in mind, Rose Johnson, who is not a professional developer, she's someone with a vision, needs a lot of help on figuring out how to do this. So that's what the students are helping her figure out.
So give me an example. Are you working on the same projects?
I'm working on with two other clients, actually.
Okay, so let's hear just a little bit more about this, and then we'll turn to yours. So what kinds of, are you writing contracts? What legal work are you actually doing?
So for Rose and the North Gulfport Community Land Trust, we have been researching financing options. They want to build affordable housing, so we've been
Are there tax credits?
That.
Are
there
laws
yes.
that allow this to happen?
Yes. So we're researching all of that, and also partnership structures. So what would work best for the North Gulfport Community Land Trust? David mentioned this, but it's very important that the land trust maintain community control over the project, and that's not always how affordable housing development is done. So this is different in that way. And the financing and partnership structures really do flow from that goal.
That bottom line.
Yes.
Very cool. So Eva, tell me about your clients.
So to flow from the Community Land Trust, actually, my first client is Providence Community Housing, which is a nonprofit housing developer, and they are actually redeveloping one of the formerly biggest public housing projects in New Orleans. It was destroyed. Four big public housing projects were destroyed after Katrina. In my opinion, no, they weren't necessarily blighted. They just shut down, and so
they weren't flooded.
I don't believe
there was some flooding. There was a lot of controversy over. Mm-hmm. whether they were so badly damaged that they couldn't be rehabbed relatively inexpensively. The the truth seems to be that the city of New Orleans was waiting for a while for an opportunity to tear down these projects and build something that was less dense, which a lot of people agreed with, and a lot of people on the other side thought that these were people's homes, and,
right.
and people deserved to continue to live there if they wanted to. In the end, the decision was made to demolish them, but groups like Providence Community Housing are redeveloping them, and in this case, and not every group is doing that, they're doing a one-to-one replacement of all the affordable units. So anyone who wants to could theoretically come home, and some have actually already moved back to the site. But
and what kind of, tell me about the kind of work that you're doing.
So we're actually, to get back to sort of the community voice theme, we're actually helping we're assisting the residents in developing their bylaws. There are going to be over 1,000 residents potentially there, so it's going to be a very big community, and we want to make sure, and our client wants to make sure that they have a voice in the development, and eventually when the development is built, you know, they have a strong tenant association and homeowners association, because there are also some first-time homeowners who are on the site. So we went down there and we talked with the residents and made sure that, you know, all of their concerns are addressed in the bylaws. And it sounds sort of simple, it sounds sort of boring, bylaws, but it's actually really important, because since the development is just being built, the process of developing board members and the election process and things like that, they're all new, and so it's fairly complex.
I think this is a good example, though, and the Lawyers Committee, because we're a national organization and we're in D.C., we're not on the ground all the time, and, you know, fortunately I get to travel there, and I get to travel to a place like New Orleans pretty often, but, you know, we're not part of that community. With the Providence Community Housing, we are co-counseling with the Southeast Louisiana Legal Services, which is the legal aid there, specifically with a woman named Renee Davis, who they met when they were there. I was not able to go on this trip, but my boss, Diane Glauber, went, and she did a great job. You know, so we really have these local partnerships. We're partnering with, you know, the client, of course, Providence Community Housing, who are wonderful advocates and very knowledgeable about the field and really care about the community and the residents. And then with legal aid attorneys who know, already have relationships with the tenants and with the client, and, you know, are happy to have the additional help. So it's a great collaboration.
6 years ago, UDC law students and faculty, led by three faculty members, Will McLean, Lori Morin, and Susan Weisdorf, developed an alternative spring break Katrina project, and I actually got to go on the first one, and 40 of us went down and worked to help folks affected by Katrina. Some of us worked in the Public Defender Service. So, you know, it was 18 months after Katrina, and they didn't have judges, and they didn't have lawyers right. for the government, and they didn't have lawyers for the defense. And so we walked 39 people out of jail who'd already served more time than they would have had they been convicted and mm-hmm. given the maximum amount of time. Mm-hmm. Some law students and a couple of us on the faculty. Other folks worked with homeowners, helping them get the documents they needed to get road home money to get rebuilding done. And others worked to help primarily immigrant workers paid because they were being taken horrible advantage of by unscrupulous contractors who would put them to work for a couple weeks and then disappear and not pay them and felt that they could get away with it because people wouldn't come back to them because of their status in being illegal. And some were. But we helped in all three of those areas. And every year, a group of UDC students has carried on that tradition and going down to do that work as an alternative spring break. So you're not the "we went to Miami to the beach" crowds. You're the "we went to Gulfport and represented low-income people and communities and helped them achieve their dreams." That's all. Very cool. Aw, I love that about you guys. So was it a great trip? What was it like for you?
It was a great trip, and it was really interesting to see sort of some of the differences in how the redevelopment is occurring, though the organizations we're working with are sort of trying to sort of change the way it is working now. Basically, a lot of the sort of traditionally higher income white communities that where there are tourists, that's where a lot, you know, it seems like there's a lot of life. a lot of the neighborhoods we went into, for example, the Treme, historically African-American, low-income neighborhood of Treme, just that's where you see a lot of blight. And another client of ours is working to redevelop that area, bring back artists and musicians. And so it was really great to physically see the differences and how our organizations are actually making a difference in developing in these blighted areas.
You're not going to believe it. We have 2 minutes left. I'm going to give you gosh. 1 minute and you 1 minute, and then you can take us home with 10 seconds. How about that?
Well, Dean Broderick, I just want to thank you for inviting us onto this show. And it's just been a great experience to be able to share what we've done. And it was really great to have the opportunity to work with the Lawyers Committee and the Community Development Law Clinic and meet our amazing clients. So thanks.
Yeah, also thank you. And it's been a great experience working with the Community Development Clinic as a whole and with the Lawyers Committee. I never really thought I would do community development, but now I think I actually want to practice in the area. And thank you for bringing us on the show and showing us how we can take our experiences to the DC community.
I'm looking forward to it.
Sure. I just want to say, you know, when people ask me what I like about my job, my favorite thing about my job are the clients and the advocates that we get to represent. Close second is working with the students from UDC. It's been a fantastic experience. Eva's going to stick with us for the summer, which we're really glad about. And thank you so much for letting us share.
My very great pleasure. Low-income communities in the District of Columbia and surrounding region face many issues that may not require litigation, but need legal assistance with real estate, land use, environmental, and other transactional legal matters. If you are a nonprofit or community-based organization in the DC area, and you are looking for legal assistance with affordable housing, community organizing and advocacy, environmental justice, or other community issues, the Community Development Project may be able to help connect you with the right resources. You can reach them by contacting David Zisser at 202-662-8600. I'm Shelley Broderick. Thanks for watching, and please join me next time for more sound advice.